What's up, what's up? Hey, how y'all doing this morning? Y'all feeling good? Listen, man, it's going to be a good day, man. I'm so glad you made it, man. It's going to be a lot of fun. Let me tell you something. Last week was crazy. How many made it to Easter last week? Anybody? Let me hear you. Dude, you know the weather was insane, man, so thank you for fighting the weather, going through all that, and I actually have a little weather report, because sometimes people are like, how bad was the weather really right there at CenturyLink? Was it really bad? Well, we went ahead and dialed in, and we have actually a weather announcement. This is, I think, really live. You'll be able to see it. Watch this right here.
Let's go live to Ollie Williams with the weather report. Ollie?
It's raining sideways!
Sounds rough, Ollie. Do you have an umbrella?
Had one!
Where is it?
Inside out, 2 miles away!
Is there anything we can do for you?
Bring me some soup!
What kind?
Chunky!
All right, we'll get on that.
Okay, that's all I'm saying, dude. It was crazy, and people still fought to get in that building, man. Soaking wet, they got their families there, and here's the deal. Everybody said, how many people? Over 10,000 people. Crazy. Here's some pictures just so you can kind of see it. That's what it looked like in there. It was insane, man, and people were fighting to make sure that they could just get inside and be a part of it, and you were probably one of those, so thank you for making that happen. It was awesome. We also had a great baptism, 90-something baptisms. Here's just a couple of pictures. Some of them were outside, then we moved it inside. It was really phenomenal, so thank you for helping us to make it a memorable night that we'll never forget, a memorable day, excuse me. So again, if you're here, let me tell you something. If you're a guest, you walked in, they give you a communication card. We want you to fill out the back of it, and then you can drop into one of the giving stations on the way out. It's the best way to communicate with us about all that's going on in your life, and then we can tell you about what's going on in the Simple Church. And to do that today, I have a video that's going to help you, because everybody's like, what's next after Easter? What's coming up? Well, here's a little video just to remind you of what's coming up. Watch this.
Bride, this is the last of the Easter stuff, man. We finally got it all put away.
Man, that is great, John. Listen, everybody's asking, what's next?
Well, we got a lot coming up, Brian, right? I mean, today the Do Good Stores open to the boardwalk from 1 to 6, and then seminars are tonight.
Oh, yeah. You're talking about the round two of the seminars will be tonight, starting at 4 o'clock with Justin's Spiritual Growth, and then the rest of them follow at 5, right?
Absolutely, right here at the Convention Center. So all you have to do to be a part of that is email julie@thesimplechurch.tv to RSVP. Let us know you're coming, and you can be there today at 4 or 5 for any of the seminars. And then this morning, the bracelets for Holiday and Dixie go on sale, right, John?
Man, I almost forgot about Holiday and Dixie. April 21st, this month, at 11 o'clock, that is going to be our church service for that day at Festival Plaza in downtown Shreveport. But the bracelet's really important, because if you want to ride anything at all, that's the way to go, because they're half price if you buy them here today. Go to the purple tents at the Convention Center or stop by Volunteer Information Table at Boardwalk and get your bracelet today, man.
Wow, man, that's a lot of stuff going on, man. How are we going to wrap up the month?
On April 28th, you know, we have the worship night. Special guest Lincoln Brewster's coming in. We're going to rent out Municipal Auditorium. It's going to be a really cool night, but seating's limited, so you have to have a free ticket to get in. Next Sunday will be your first chance to pick up those free tickets at the Convention Center or at the Boardwalk.
Man, we have a lot of stuff going on this month.
We really do.
What are you guys doing? We got work to do. Come
Shotgun.
On.
Hey, I got your back.
All right. That's exactly right, man. You need to make sure you write all that down. Take your bulletin so you don't forget. Get your bracelet today for Holiday and Dixie. It's going to be fun. We'll be outside having the church service. One service, 11 o'clock. It's going to be fun, though, because it's going to be an abbreviated service. They're having the food booths open for us, but you got to have a bracelet if you want to ride, and you can get them half price today. They're out there in the lobby, so don't forget it. And it'll be in the weeks coming. You can even pick them up at the Do Good store today if you'd like to, all right? It's going to be a ton of fun today. Let me give you a little background. It is a one-of-a-kind day. You got here on a day that has never happened in Simple Church before, and it's going to be special. But I got to give you a little history, a little background before it happens. And it's got a lot to do with the 80s and 90s and a lot of bad hair. But you're going to see all that in just a couple of minutes, all right? But it is going to be fun. So watch this video. I'm going to come back because we have a special guest, and it's going to tell you a little bit more about who it is. Watch this.
Hey, good morning, Simple Church. This is one of these cool days. You're going to be glad you came to church. You know, last week we talked about this whole idea of celebrity versus what a hero is. Well, today it's going to be special because I'm going to introduce you to some thinks he's a celebrity. I mean, and I think he's a celebrity for sure. But many of you, you won't think that because you've never heard of him. This guy's not very popular in our current world, but man, did he make a difference in my life. This guy is a hero. You go, well, who are you talking about? Well, his name is Geoff Moore. Had an amazing band, man, back in the day, and he was the first guy to ever give me a chance, man. Let our band open up for his band. Actually gave me a chance to go on the road. When I lived in Nashville chasing the dream, he was the guy that made it possible. And let me tell you something, man, he taught me a lot about what the Simple Church is all about, how to be a servant. And I want to tell you a little bit more about it. So listen, let's get a little history so you can understand why it's a big deal that he's here today. All right, you got to remember, it's the 80s, man, and there was no better place to get good music in the 80s than, that's right, right here at the Hearst Coliseum. There was only one problem, though. My mom was like, no, sir, man, when you were a Christian, you didn't really go to that place. So what'd we do? We snuck in, man. We snuck in. We saw Rad, David Lee Roth, man, Journey, all of the great artists, man. We were like, this is the place to go. But I got to be honest with you, man, back then, Christian music was very, very small. And MTV and rock bands were huge, and that was the problem because the church went against all of that, started burning all the albums. You couldn't like rock music. So again, what's a guy like me to do, man? I was torn because, man, I was seeing it, I was influenced by it, and didn't know what to do. And my mom had an answer. All right, it's 1984, and I was standing in this very spot in this store trying to figure out, man, what am I gonna do? Because I loved music, man. And my mom worked here, Christian Life Tapes and Books. She's like, hey, son, they got Christian rock. I'm like, Christian rock? What is Christian rock music? I mean, that's crazy. I don't know anything about that because it wasn't very popular back then. She was like, look, come up to the store. It's your birthday. Pick out one cassette. I'll give it to you as your one of your presents. I'm like, I wasn't very excited, but I was like, okay, it's a gift, man. I'll go. So I came in right here in this very building. Looked very similar. Only difference, these shelves right here were packed with all kind of Christian artists. And in the middle of all that, I'm like, man, I don't know any of these people, much like you today. Who are these guys you're talking about? I didn't know either. Looked up there, man, I was like, dude, I'm 15 years old. I love MTV, I love rock and roll. How am I gonna make a choice about who to pick? I was like, you know what? I'm a man. Hey, dude, what if they got any good looking women up there? You know, so I'm looking, man, is there any good looking women? Dude, no, Amy Grant wasn't that hot. You know what I'm saying? So I'm looking up, I didn't see it. But all of a sudden now I'm like, no, look, dude, try to find some dude that looks cool, man, that fits the part, man, of rock and roll. Grabbed a cassette, man, and this is the cover that I saw right there. Geoff Moore, Over the Edge. What made it cool? Look at them glasses, dude. That's some Tom Cruise glasses, baby. And believe it or not, man, that choice impacted and changed everything for me. What's crazy is, man, from picking up this cassette tape in this store to less than 10 years, man, away from that moment, I was in the bus with Geoff Moore, traveling the U.S., traveling all over Canada. I couldn't believe it. This guy that I chose randomly, really, just because he looked cool, now had given me a chance in the music industry to experience it, to understand that it wasn't about celebrity, it was about service. And he was a servant. He is a servant. And I'm excited today, man, because it influenced my life and it influences the very church you're in today. Because without him, man, I really believe this, we wouldn't be who we are today. And I get to introduce him to you personally. Interview him right here on this stage. Hadn't seen him in 20-something years, but I want you to put your hands together and welcome my friend, my hero. Not a celebrity, but a real hero. Welcome Geoff Moore, man, to the stage. What? Come on.
There he is right here, Geoff Moore. What's up?
Thanks, you guys.
That's it, man. Thanks, man. Let's sit down. Let's catch up.
All right.
It has been 20-plus years since I've seen you, which is really crazy to me.
And it doesn't seem possible, though.
You're looking good, baby.
I feel good.
Do you?
I got my hair.
Yeah, I don't. But that's all good, man. That's what's cool, you know, is I say that because I was a little concerned. There were some rumors out there. You had done an interview and you weren't looking so good. I was like, oh, Lord, you know, I better call him, see what's up. But then I found the footage. I mean, this is going to be a little shocking to you, but this is actual footage, they say, of an interview you had.
I have a feeling the next several minutes could be kind of shocking to me, to be honest with you.
Yes, just get ready. Here's stage one. Watch
right.
This.
Well, there's been a little speculation that I'm not aging too well. And so I thought I'd just put that to the end by letting people see just how good looking I still am and how, you know, fit and I'm staying. And so I thought I'd do it with you. But this is absolutely the last one I'll probably ever do.
See, now you know what I'm talking about, right? Wow. Now explain this. Do y'all see that? Doesn't he look better today? Come on, give him some help, right?
Yeah.
That was...
All right, what happened? What is that all about?
It was back in the day when we did these long-form videos, you know? So some director had this really cool idea that for 8 hours they could put this crazy makeup on me and I would reflect on my life as an old man. So there you have it.
Dude, I'm telling you, it is a lot of fun. And you're going to have some fun today because we're going to pick a little bit. But I want to be honest with you. This guy is one of my heroes. We talked about last week about celebrity and just the difference between a celebrity and a hero. And I'm being straight with you, man. If it wasn't for you, this church wouldn't be here. It wouldn't be the way that it is today. Just because of your influence in my life, teaching me these valuable things. So I just want to tell you personally and to your face, man, I'm grateful for you and I'm thankful. So would y'all let him know just how much we appreciate him? Because you are here as a result of this guy for sure.
Well.
People also don't know about you, and this is what's interesting because they grew up probably similar to me, and we didn't have Christian radio in this town. It was one of these things. Now they have Air One and, you know, all these different K-Love, but when I grew up, we didn't have that. But you had a lot of success. I mean, do you want to talk a little bit about some of your success?
Well, you can talk about it.
That's what I thought. He's so humble. He's like, no, but this is what I want to tell you. 1.5 million albums have been bought. What people looking for and buying and enjoying Geoff Moore music. That is crazy. And in the Christian...
A lot of those were albums, if you know what I'm saying.
But no, that's pretty crazy.
Ask your parents.
Yeah, it was an album back in the day, right? Vinyl. But what's crazy is that's a lot of music. Yeah. And then in the Christian world, they have what they call the Dove Awards. It's similar. It's just an awards thing. And I kind of messed this up earlier. I mean, you've had 10 Dove Award recognitions, which is absolutely crazy. If you don't know what a Dove Award looks like, I'll kind of roll you a little tape here just so you can see, but this is actually what they look like, and they recognize different Christian artists throughout the generations, and again, you have done over the years many, many times, but this is what everybody's familiar with, and that's the Grammys, because you've also been nominated for 4 Grammys, and the one year that I was with you was about 1992. Geoff let me borrow some of this. This was like the little CD from that whole Grammy performance, which you're talking Grammys, you're talking Dove Awards. It's pretty crazy, man, 1.5 million albums, and that's why I say you're a celebrity in one respect, because in the right circle, everybody's like, man, that's who it is. But in another way, I'm telling you, you're more of a hero than me than just a celebrity because of what you taught me and how you invested in my life. And I also want to say that you were slightly embarrassing at times as well.
That's true.
Okay, now here's...
Anybody that came up in the 80s or early 90s, well, you have incriminating pictures as
Yeah,
well.
I have really good incriminating pictures. When I tell you it's embarrassing, I'm not sure I'll be able to recover after this, but one name comes to mind, and I think you'll know when I get done, but let me give you a hint. I want to show you a little video. I was on the Friend Like You tour, and I have a little video clip from it, and I would say it's Boy George. That's all I got. Let's watch this. Let's see Boy George. Oh, yeah, that's classic right there.
I don't really know what to say other than I'm sorry.
There was some big hair back
then. Hey, for 15 minutes, that was uber cool. All right, that's all I know.
I understand. Well, I'm not going to pick on you too bad if I can't pick on myself, because let me give you a little history as well. 1991, we were a struggling band locally trying to figure out what we were going to do, and Open Eyes was our name, and we were looking for a way to break in. And the reason, again, he's such a cool friend to us now is even back then, when you were in the middle of experiencing all the success, you opened your doors and let us open up for you right here at Highland Baptist. Now, here's some pictures. I'm going to go back in time again. You'll kind of see this. That's Geoff Moore in that nice blue jumpsuit right there.
Okay,
that sweatsuit was nice. Roscoe's there in the middle.
Comfort.
Yeah, but then this was our nice flyer. Look at the print quality on that. That lets you know just how fancy we were, right? Yeah, and this is what's crazy.
Ooh, $6.
Yeah, there you go. February 8th, 1991, Geoff Moore in the distance with special guest Open Eyes. And there they are right there. Ronnie was playing bass today. He played with us today. But check out that mullet.
Cowboy J right there.
Yeah, honestly, it only gets worse.
Get out of here.
Yeah, it only gets worse.
Golden locks.
In the same way that you apologize, I must apologize. I don't know what the cowboy hat was about, and I don't know what these outfits were about, but God, those are some sweet hair. Look at that right there, man, right? Alan is a good friend, and you know what's crazy? He is actually here today. You haven't seen Alan in probably 20-something years as well. Alan, come on up. Let's see what he looks like. Let's get a little reminiscent. All right? I think he's got a little different look. There he is right there. Y'all give it up for Alan, man, our open-eyes guitar player. Good friend, man. Well, dude, this is what's crazy, and it is fun just to get to see everybody again, and we're kind of having a little reminisce moment, but let me tell you something. It is so important to me to make sure that they understand what it's about in this whole thing, and I got to keep the record straight as well. Sometimes people say, well, what did you do, Justin? Did you play guitar, keyboards, whatever? No, I played nothing. I was the roadie. You know what I'm saying? That was what made me famous, and I say this is because you didn't care. You treated us all the same. I have some roadie pictures just so you can understand. I never played an instrument, didn't do anything, but I carried a mean cable. You know what I'm saying? Right there, I was able to carry the cables. There was my monitor board. Most nights, that's what I sat behind. But what was crazy, there's Greg Harrington. You got Guy Platter, Alan, and me. That's our bus. That's the glamorous Christian life bus right there. That's what you did, man. You traveled. So notice he covers his nose in that picture on the right. Things happen in that bus that are embarrassing to everybody, all right? But it was also about friendship because when you see this right here, we had a great time. Took a skiing. We had a lot of fun. 12 months, less than 12 months, excuse me, traveled almost every state in the U.S., Canada 4 times. We were busy, man. Was that hard on you in your whole life at that point as well, or was it fun?
Well, it was both, and that's what I think. You know, when you are fortunate enough to get to do what you feel like God's created you to do, you get a chance to not only work hard, but to enjoy the whole journey and experience. And you're right, man. And I tell you, when you say I treated everybody the same, that's not because I'm like some superhuman leader, you know? It's because I get up every day and I remember what Jesus did for me and that I am a worthless loser and that he blessed me with life and with friends, you know? And if he, you know, man, he became a servant, right? So, I mean, that's like this great example. So I just tried to do that with everybody that worked with us. And then, you know, occasionally they become the pastor of a mega church. So who saw that one coming?
Yeah, whatever.
But I will tell you, man, that I think the fun that we had is what made the hard work so much easier to take, you know, because it was the complete experience. We were in relationship with each other.
Right.
Worked hard, played hard, were honest with each other, had a lot of fun.
And that's what's interesting, even the Simple Church, it's a lot of hard work, even in just setting up material. And there are a tremendous amount of people behind the scenes making it happen even today.
Yeah.
And that's why I tell everyone here that makes it happen, setting up, tearing down, taking care of kids, all those things. I'm telling you, dude, that example comes from Geoff Moore. I just want y'all to know again that he invested in me in order for us to turn around and invest back. And it's very special to me because, again, I was a roadie. I wasn't on the stage, never really got on the stage other than, you know, our little opening up acts and stuff.
Right.
But I felt like I was a part of it. And that friendship is something I cherish to this day. And that's really what this church is about as well, is creating these friendships, keeping these friendships going. So, again, I learned every bit of that from you. And I got another little funny video just because I'm here to really razz you. Because friends do that, Geoff. We torture each other, okay? So here's another little old clip. This is all about friendship. This was called Life Together. It's another great video from the 90s. Absolutely, some of the best hair. Is that not amazing hair? You know what I'm saying? Like the product that was used was awesome.
Apparently,
right?
I brought my marching band uniform over for that video too. Wow.
And they had the plaid going on. But let me just say, that was Roscoe, who again is from Shreveport, played with the Simple Church some, and I think he's at Broadmoor right now. And he's just a great guy, but you had a lot of influence of Shreveport musicians in your
studio. And that's one of the reasons, y'all, it's really special for me to be here today, is because this community has given so much to my music and ministry. Started with Geoff Barkley, I play keys, and Roscoe, and then every time we had an opening, you know, for a musician or a crew, anybody, they'd be like, we know a guy in Louisiana, you know, and so it was just, people just kept coming, and every one of them bring a box of Southern Made Donuts with them. So I was
amen.
Like, you are hired.
Yes,
right there.
Amen. So. Well, speaking of great friends and great hair, and this was, again, one of my great friends, and he had the best hair back in the 1990s. I'm going to tell you right now. I want to introduce to the crowd here and let you see again. Mr. Geoff Barkley is here, the keyboard player. Awesome, so y'all give Geoff a round of applause. Geoff, where you at, big man? Come on up. Still got amazing hair, dude. This guy was the keyboard player that went all over the world with us, you know, and they have been together a long time.
Geoff and I played at least 10 to 12 years together, and he never missed a show in all that time. You'd think somebody would died or got married or something, but he was there. And I mean, talk about the places that we have stood together in stages all over the world. So it's awesome to
be in a minute, Geoff, I'm gonna get you to come out and play. But let me say one thing about Geoff Barkley. Geoff Barkley is the greatest smelling man on the planet. If you just wanna know that, I traveled the world with him and he smells good. Come here, hold on. Oh, that's so good. You can smell him later. He'll be around, okay? So just we'll see you in just a minute. Sit down, and then we're going to do a quick song. But let me tell you, since we're talking about friendship and this whole idea, there's also a close friend of yours, Mr. Stephen Curtis Chapman, which many people may have heard before, very, very popular in Christian music world. Tell me a little bit about your friendship and your connection with him. How did that happen?
Yeah, we met as songwriters in the mid-'80s, and we both that's what we started doing, and we became friends. We are both newly married, and so We sat down and talked about music and about women, and we were a lot more successful in the music side of it than trying to understand being newly married. But they've been our best friends all through these years.
Well, he is an amazing guy. If you don't know, this is some old footage of him. This is about, again, back in the 90s. I'll just kind of show you. That's what they looked like back then, Stephen Curtis and Geoff Moore. And this video is actually from one of my favorite songs, and it's called Listen to Our Hearts. And the reason this is such a special song is because there was a lot of confusion over worship, and it was kind of moving from entertainment and concerts into worship. Tell me just a little bit about that as the
band
gets some play.
I came up in such a conservative church, and in some of the early concerts we did were in super charismatic churches, and I was like, what are these people doing? Put your hands down. And, and so it just took me a while to figure it out. And what I arrived at was, it really doesn't matter what the outward thing is. What matters is what's going on in your heart. Are you authentic? Are you being honest with God? And so, you know, that's where that song was born.
Well, Stephen Curtis, and this is a picture of him now, of what he looks like, just so you can kind of see what Stephen looks like now in this generation. But let me tell you something, you two together are special, and y'all write some amazing songs. And do y'all want to hear one today? Would y'all like to hear a little Listen to Our Hearts? Could you do it for us, man?
Yes, okay, only if you sing it with me, all right?
I'll try. This is old school.
Listen to our hearts.
Please listen.
simple song of praise
from those you have redeemed.
Those you have redeemed.
And we will use the words we know to tell you what an awesome God you are. The words are not enough to tell you of our love. So listen to us. Hear our spirit sing,
and hear us sing
a song of praise,
simple song of praise
from those you have redeemed.
Those you have redeemed,
and we will use the words we know to tell you what an awesome God you are. The words are not enough to tell you of our love, so listen to our hearts. And words are not enough to tell you of our love, so listen to our hearts.
That, my friends, is old school. That's old school right there, man. Did y'all enjoy that? Is that good or what, huh?
Thank y'all. Thank you.
Well, let me tell you, man, this is what's amazing about you is there's some great times and great memories we have, a lot of great friendships. Geoff, thanks for playing, coming in and playing keyboards as well. But there's also some difficult times. I mean, in the last 20 years, it's been some really tough situations. Stephen Curtis, your good friend as well. Had a tragic accident when his son accidentally ran over one of his daughters. Both of y'all have adopted from China,
right.
And have kids, and he accidentally just had an accident, and man, it was a mess. And what was going on with that? I mean, such dark time. How was that? How did you get through that?
Well, you know, man, as we talk about just friendship and the relationships even that are here with me today in this community, when those things really pay off is when the bottom drops out, you know? And so I encourage you, as I encourage my heart, that we be authentic in our friendships and relationships. I don't think you need a million, but you need a few that will walk through the funk with you, you know? And that's what we were able to do. You know, some of you have lost kids or you know people that have. If there's a worse tragedy, I don't want to know about it. It was awful, but it wasn't hopeless. You and I know each other well enough to know that I try and be as honest as I can. And I will tell you, y'all, that there were days that were just the saddest that I have ever imagined could exist. I mean, this little girl was one of my daughter's best friends, you know. But with God as my witness, I mean, it was so overwhelmingly dark and hard sometimes. But we were never alone. We never felt alone. And I'd encourage you all in that. God will meet us in the dark. It does not matter how hard or lost or goofed up it is. He will meet us and He'll lead us out.
You know, I say that because there's so many people in here today that, man, you walked in here and you got junk, man. I mean, stuff is happening. I mean, one of my good friends, I know you'd lost one of our friends that we grew up with even back in those times to pancreatic cancer. I got a friend battling right now, Randy. I mean, I know, man, you're fighting and trying to hang in there and go through that whole process. We had a girl tragically killed in a car wreck. Just this past week, 17 years old, went to Simple Church. Her family, just a sweet family, and trying to make it through that. I heard Rick Warren's son, big pastor in Saddleback out in the West Coast, his son committed suicide last night. We've had that happen in this church with different situations like that. We had a good friend that traveled with us that did that as well.
Yeah.
And how do you do it? I know you're saying you have those things, but is there a particular way? Is there something you can, you know, specifically do, or how in the world do you get through that?
Well, I know that when we were in, you know, some of those darkest moments, we would just say, this is either true or it's not, you know? If this isn't true, what are we doing here? We are wasting our time. I believe that it is, and I believe that as a follower of Jesus Christ, there's no guarantees that it's going to be awesome all the time. In fact, if you read our Bible, the truth is that the guarantee is that it's going to be awful sometimes. And so for all the amazing, beautiful places that following Jesus has taken me to some of the hardest and darkest places, it's part of the journey. The thing is we don't walk alone. And so I have found in my life and through this journey that the love of Jesus the reality that His grace, His support is sufficient for us is true, that He's there for us. And that's what I found. And it's one of those things, even as you look back on it, I don't know if you have things like this, you don't even know how you got through it, you know? That's because God intervened in our lives. That's what He does. He intervenes.
Well, He wrote a great song to help you get through some of these times and some of the dark times. And my prayer is that as He plays it now, that it would encourage you, it would strengthen you. I said it in some of the other services, but Randy, I know specifically for you, man, this is for you, for the family that lost, again, a child. I pray as you're watching, as you're here, that you would understand that there is hope and there is an answer. And this song celebrates that.
When the storm clouds roll over me, when I'm seized by uncertainty, when the odds are too great, when I bend from the way, I believe. When the night falls and darkness closes in, and the fear of doubt comes creeping in, though my eyes start to blur and I can't be too sure, I believe in the way that you have set me free. I believe in the truth of all you've said to me.
Now you know why I love him so much, man. Oh. Great songwriter, man. Great song. And I also know one of the things I admire about you most that it affected me as well, not just the friendship aspect and the service aspect, and I mean, there's so many things. The mission aspect, compassion. You've worked with Compassion for a long time, helping sponsor kids, and we're big about that here. I just want you to know that one of the things that still affects me is the way your family loved you. You loved your family. Family was a priority in the midst of all that was going on. Tell me just a little bit about that.
Well, you know, it's my wife and I always joke. It's funny. One thing when you're in a music career, people say they love you that don't know you, you know? And it's easier to listen to them than it is to the people that do know you sometimes. So, you know, being on the road is a place that you get a lot of affirmation. And, you know, my wife was always good about balancing that. You know, I'd come home and she'd be like, I know you've probably changed people's lives, but there's dog crap in the backyard that needs to be picked up, you know, that kind of stuff. So,
that's what I'm talking
you know,
about.
She kept it balanced. But I've been blessed, man, you know, with just a wife and a family that has revolutionized my life. Our little adopted girls have just ruined me to, you know, and all the great ways of life. And
Let me show a picture, so y'all can see. Yeah. Here's Jeff, minus Jan, his wife. This is his family, though,
it's
just so you can kind of know.
My boys, and I'm so blessed to have them, and you know, that's the thing, that I just feel like I've stood on their shoulders all these years.
Well, listen, I am trying to follow in your footsteps, and I'm going to brag on my family as well, because I'm telling you, this is a picture of my family, and she looks good, son. That is a good looking woman right there.
It's funny, she doesn't look blind.
No, she don't have her glasses on right there. I mean, she wears glasses normally to kind of, you know, help her out, but
can we just pause for a minute and thank the Lord that those kids look like their mother?
Yeah. Absolutely. That's my beautiful babies, man. But let me tell you, I'm married over my head. I get nosebleeds, but it's all right, all right?
It's all right.
And then just to brag, too, one other picture. We had baptism, too. Little Emma got baptized and Ian got baptized. I promised I'd show it. I got to let them know,
that's
man.
Awesome.
There you are, baby girl, and there you are, baby boy.
That's awesome.
Last Sunday, which is really, really cool. And what I love about this, one of my favorite songs you've ever done is called The Keeper, okay?
Yeah.
And if I would really stretch you, I'd make you do it, but I'm not. But I listen to your newer albums, and I'm telling you, there's some great songs, and they all focus on this idea of family and the value of family. So I'm going to challenge you, ask you if you don't mind, band's up here, can we go ahead and do one? And it's called Saying Grace. Give us a little bit about it, what it's about as you get ready to play.
Yeah, it's just it's about living a life of thankfulness. You know, I grew up in a great family, and I'm trying to lead a great family. And one of the things we did, I know it sounds simple, we ate our meals together. We sat around a table. And sometimes my mom had to chain us to it, but we were there. And that's been a big thing for us. And we try and do it. And you know, I think that imagery of sitting together is a biblical one, where God calls us into this community. So yeah, it's a song about, really about my mom's good cooking and about living a life of thankfulness.
That's what I'm talking about. Y'all wanna hear it?
All right.
Let him hear it, come on.
They were all together for the very last time. the bread would soon be broken, then the spilling of the wine. And this is my life, I'm pouring out for you. So always remember in everything you do to open your mouth and say
sounds like, I'm hearing all this. I mean, it seems like we've mellowed a little. Is it just me, or are we getting older? Is it
well,
like...
it's, you know, we're keeping it classy.
Okay, okay, yeah, because it used to be a day we were edgy.
We were.
You were the leader in that, though.
I was.
Okay, now I have a picture, because this guy back on the keyboard, he was pretty edgy as well. Now, that just lets you know, that's true edge right there. Do you see what I'm saying? That is just beautiful right there. Geoff, thank you for cutting it. Okay, that's what I'm saying, all right? You can thank me as well, all right? But what's crazy is I was just
like
wondering.
It's like a helmet.
What I'm wondering is I got an old friend. Where's Alan at? Alan, you made it back. Yeah, you're looking good too. You've aged gracefully. We're there. But my question, I guess, all of us is do you think we still have it?
I think we may have it.
Do you think we still have it? That's my question. See, the reason I ask, yeah, I know, the reason I ask is there was a song that we really did a lot. I mean, and it was a staple in the whole idea of what Geoff Moore's about. It was called Why Should the Devil Have All the Good Music? Pretty good title, right? It was a reminder when the Christians were burning their albums, we were trying to go, no, dude, we got something for you, right?
Right.
You led us. Larry Norman, you've helped me. So do you think you can muster it up? I know you're old, but
dude,
you think
this
you got
is
it?
Like, you are digging deep into the friendship now. This is like going...
You just watch Daddy work. That's what I'm going to say. Go ahead. Here we go. Let's get it on.
Well, y'all better stand up when you start. Stand up on your feet. Come on. Take it away, Mr. Moore. I want the people to know that it saved my soul. Still, I can listen to the radio. Rock and roll is what I'm going to give it one more chance. I feel so good, I want to get up and dance. Driving me insane, a good outlaw to make room for my brain. But sometimes people don't understand what's the reverend doing in a rock and roll band. There's nothing wrong with playing blues. If you got a reason, tell it in my face. Why should the devil have all the good music? I've been filled, I feel
Service. Y'all want to sing with us one time? I said, do you want to sing with us one time? It goes like this.
Tell me, why should the devil have all the good music?
Your turn.
Why?